So my name is Mr. Winchell. I know most of you guys in here, so thank you guys for signing up for my class. So this is Intro to Beekeeping. I am a beekeeper. I've been doing this for 5 or 6 years at this point. I was going to bring in some lip balm to raffle off, but I forgot to bring it this morning. Maybe I'll try to bring some in another time. If some of you guys stop by, I can get you guys some. But I want to go through some basic stuff today. I want to talk about honey. This is all about European honeybees. I want to talk about the different types of honeybees. I want to get into their genetics, because I'm a biology teacher, so I'm going to use a little biology involved in this lesson. I want to talk about how the bees develop over the course of their lifetime. Like if you guys have seen the Bee movie, they get into that a little bit. There's a lot of inaccuracies in that movie. And then I'll talk a little bit about what's involved in if you want to get involved into beekeeping. It's kind of a fun hobby to get into. It's a little costly at first, but makes money in the end if you want to. Okay, so as far as honeybees go, there are three types of honeybees, three castes of honeybees in a hive. You have your workers, your drones, and your queen. Okay, now the one you guys are probably most familiar with, most of you guys, when you think of honeybees, you probably think of the queen. The queen is the largest bee in the hive. There's generally one of them in the hive. Sometimes you will get two. If I have time for this, I'll talk about this later. The queens will actually battle to the death. Only one will survive, but the queen is the only bee in the hive, usually, that is able to lay eggs. Okay, she is the one that's laying the eggs, and the eggs turn into either a worker or a drone. Now, the workers are the ones you guys see all around. These are the ones that are on the flowers, collecting the pollen and the nectar, bring it back to the hive. These are your females. Okay, they make up the vast majority of your bees. If you come to my beehive, I have three of them in my yard at the moment. In the middle of summer, I might have like 70,000 bees per hive. I want you to think about that. About 98 to 99% of them are these ones, females. Okay, the drones, these are ones you guys are probably not as familiar with. You may have never seen one in your lifetime. These are the males. They're a little bit bigger than the females. They look different. You can tell the difference because of their size and their eyes. These are the males, which I'm going to come back to in a minute. They're very rare as far as the bees go. They only make about 1% of the hive. Okay, so as far as the genetics go here, and I think this is the most interesting part about honeybees, the drones are what you call the males. Now, if any of you guys have taken biology yet, the males are haploid. They only have half the normal number of chromosomes. Okay, so normal honeybees, the queen and the females, they have 32 chromosomes. The males only have 16. I want you to imagine a human. We have 46 chromosomes. Imagine a human that could live with 23. Now, it's not possible in humans, but bees can live with only half the normal number of chromosomes. The males are them. They are basically an unfertilized egg. Not basically, they are. They're an unfertilized egg. The female lays an egg, okay, and does not fertilize. I mean, no sperm is involved. It's just the female's chromosomes. Okay, so the male bees, the drones, they have no father. However, they have a grandfather, okay, because if you go back two generations, the queen came from a male bee and a female. So the males have no father, but they do have a grandfather. Now, they only carry half the normal number of chromosomes, so they're all identical to each other. So every drone in the hive is identical. Now, the female, the queen, she will leave the hive once in her life, early in life, once she's developed for about like a month. She leaves and she goes and has sex with a whole bunch of male bees, drones. She has sex with about 10 to 20 of them. Now, males, I'm sorry to tell you, when the male bee has sex, he immediately dies. His endophallus and his internal chest cavity get ripped out, falls to the ground dead. Okay, the queen has sex with about 10 to 20 of them. She flies off to an area called a drone congregation area, and she has sex with a whole bunch of bees. The idea is she flies far enough away from her own hive that she's not having sex with any of her own offspring, because we want some genetic diversity involved in there. Now, she then stores the sperm inside of a little sac inside of her body called a spermatheca, and for the rest of her lifetime, she is able to lay eggs, and she chooses whether she fertilizes them or not. If she doesn't fertilize them, they become a drone. If she fertilizes them, meaning she takes one of her egg cells and one of those sperm cells which she stored up, she puts them together, she will make one of the females, which are the worker bees. Now, what's interesting about worker bees are all the females in the hive are related because they have the same mother, but they may or may not have the same father. Because remember, the queen had sex with 10 to 20 different males. So some of the females share 75% of their DNA because they got 100% of the DNA from the mother and they got 50% from the father, essentially. So they are related 75%. So if any of you guys have a sibling, you share approximately 50% of your DNA with them. Female bees, though, they're even closer related to each other. So for a long time, Charles Darwin actually had a problem with understanding honeybees when he came up with his idea of natural selection. He couldn't understand why the female workers would forego their ability to reproduce, because they're basically not passing on their own genes. Here's the reason why, at least this is the current idea. If a female worker bee lays an egg, her baby will only have 50% of her DNA. However, if the queen lays an egg, that sister will have 75% of the DNA. So the worker bees actually forego reproducing because the queen is actually going to produce an offspring that is more closely related to themselves than if they had their own kid. I don't have more time to get into that because I got a lot of stuff to get through, but there's a lot of interesting stuff here with genetics and evolution. As far as the time where they are, from the time that the eggs are laid inside of the comb to the times that they emerge, it's called emerging instead of hatching. The queen, the worker, and the drone have a slightly different time periods they need to go through until the time where they emerge out of the comb. They actually chew their way out, and then they go through the life cycle of a bee. I'm going to take you through the life cycle of all of them real quick. The queens live on average 3 to 5 years. Now, I'm going to be honest with you, in most cases, the queen only lasts about 3 years. After about 3 years, she starts getting older and she doesn't become as good at laying eggs. Once the queen starts laying eggs improperly, like she's not laying them in a good pattern or she's not laying a lot of the eggs, she stops giving off a certain pheromone. And the rest of the worker bees start realizing, hey, this queen's not cutting it anymore. So you know what they do? They actually surround her. They actually suffocate her to death. They kill their own queen. Now, before they do this, they have to promote a new queen. And I know this sounds fake, but they literally pick one of the worker bees, which is in an early stage, one of these larvae, and they feed it a special concoction of food, which we call royal jelly. This royal jelly is really high in specific proteins, and it basically turns specific chromosomes, specific genes, I should say, on, and that worker, instead of developing into a normal worker, will develop into a queen. So they basically take a random larvae and they promote it to a queen. Once that queen is born, they kill the old queen, because now the idea is this new queen will be able to produce more babies and will be better for the hive survival in the long term. But on average, they live about 3 to 5 years. The drones, I told you, drones serve one purpose. Their only purpose is to have sex with a female. Okay, that's it. They're made. There's only about 1% of the hive is these guys, because let's say I am a beehive. The males in my beehive serve no function to my specific beehive. They serve a function to honeybees in general because they keep honeybees going, propagating, because they're going to go and have sex with a queen from a different hive, and the genetics from my hive will now get propagated into another hive, hopefully in the future. Now, again, I told you males, if it ever ends up having sex with a female, it immediately dies. If you don't end up having sex with a female, at the end of the season, when fall starts coming around, the female worker bees literally drag the males out and just throw them out of the hive. And they basically let them starve to death. Why? Because they no longer serve a purpose throughout winter. They're bigger and they eat more honey, so the worker bees throw them out of the hive and let them starve to death. So male bees serve a kind of interesting life. Okay, now the female bees, the workers, once they've emerged from the larvae and they've become a fully functional adult bee, the first couple days of their life, they basically just clean out the cell that they were born in. They clean it out, they take the refuse, and they actually take it out of the hive, and they get it out. Then they become what are called nurse bees. Okay, for about days 4 through 12, their job is basically to feed the baby larvae. Okay, they will go and they will feed them nectar and pollen, which is the protein. They'll feed the larvae, and they will check them 1,300 times per day, each little larvae. I know you can't really see in this picture, but down in the honeycomb are some little larvae. I'll show you a better picture in a second. Now, after they become, while they're in the nursing phase, they also, some of them will attend to the queen bee. The queen bee can't take care of herself at all. She can't feed herself, and she can't even take care of her own biological functions as far as waste go. So the nurse bees will actually feed her. They'll actually bring her food. They have this little proboscis. It's this little tube that comes out and actually feed directly. They feed the queen nectar and pollen straight to her mouth. The queen also has to defecate. The worker bees will actually eat it, take it out of the hive, and get rid of it for her because she doesn't have time for those tasks. Okay, once the bees are kind of graduate and become no longer nurse bees, they are able to make wax. There are certain glands on the bottom of the bee's abdomen. I'm not going to read all this to you. This is a bee on the abdomen. You see these little flakes right here? These are wax. The bees are able to eat honey, and they are able to biologically produce wax out of that honey. Now, the problem is this is a very costly process. It takes 6 pounds of honey to make 1 pound of wax. And the bees need the wax because that's what they make all their honeycomb out of. Actually, sorry, let me get my honeycomb out. I'll pass some of this around. This is the most costly process in building a beehive because you need a lot of wax to lay some eggs and store some honey. I'm just gonna pass this around. This is old wax from another hive. I don't know, I'm just gonna throw some on some tables, just pass them around. That's what it kind of looks like. These ones are not the best pieces because, again, they're old. Just look at some of them. But this wax is costly to make. I'll take this back at the end of class, by the way. So the first year you have a beehive, the bees spend basically the entire year, every bit of honey they make for the first part of the year, they consume it and use it to make the wax because they have to fill out the frames that I'm going to talk about in a couple minutes for the wax. This is super, super costly process. So the first year you have a beehive, you generally don't get any honey. Or if you do, you get very little because most of the honey is devoted to this purpose, making wax. Okay, the bees will make the wax. They'll actually chew it up, make it soft, and they'll like regurgitate it, and they'll build it into the honeycomb shape. Now again, the wax I just passed around, you may or may not have got a piece that has a nice honeycomb. This is called burr comb. This is kind of the comb I just scraped off of random places. So you may not have got a piece which has a nice honeycomb shape to it, but that's how they make it. Okay, these bees also are in charge of receiving the nectar from the foragers. Eventually the bees get old enough and they leave the hive and they will go get the nectar and the pollen. These bees will come into the hive and they will literally transfer the nectar from the worker bee to one of these nurse bees. So they'll actually regurgitate it into this bee. Okay, so they'll transfer the nectar from one bee to another. Other bees, before they've left the hive yet, will become guard bees. If you come out to, you're not going to come to my house, but if you did, if you came in the middle of summer, you'd see some bees sitting on the outside of the hive, and they'll just sit there. They are guard bees. They're basically looking for intruders, which may be a yellow jacket, maybe a bear, maybe me. Okay? If something is that they think is going to threaten the hive, like this yellow jacket, these guard bees will release a little pheromone, a little chemical signature, and we call it an attack pheromone. They release it, and the bees, because the bees can't talk, they communicate via this pheromone. This pheromone tells the other bees in the hive, there's an intruder near, and this will cause a lot of the worker bees to fly out of the hive and attack whatever that thing is, whether it's me or somebody else.
What's the difference between the drone and the guard bees?
Drone and what? So the drones, again, are males. They literally just, the drones will just sit in the hive and eat honey all day until they fly out and try to find a queen to have sex with. That's it. They won't, in fact, the drones don't even have a stinger. You could put a drone on you and do whatever you want to. It cannot sting you. It does not have a stinger. The only ones that do are the queen, the females, the queens and the workers. So these are all worker bees, which are all females. If you guys have ever seen like the bee movie or on TV, you see people smoking the hive. I didn't bring a smoker in, but I literally put sticks and twigs in there and I set it on fire and I put some stuff on it to cool it down and I put a little lid on it and it blows smoke out. The smoke is literally there for one purpose. It basically confuses the bees. It masks that pheromone so the bees cannot communicate with each other, and therefore, hopefully, they won't attack me while I'm tending to the bees. If you come to a beehive on a warm day, you'll see a lot of bees sitting out front. This is not a lot, by the way. This is very few. You will see them more like this. They'll be on the outside of the hive, particularly near the entrances, and they're doing what's called fanning the hive. They literally will beat their wings to draw air in and out of the hive, basically to cool it off. So this is what they do on a very warm summer day so they don't overheat. Once the bees get to about 20 days, they're ready to leave the hive. They're ready to become the foragers. OK, Okay, but they've never flown a day in their life. So there's basically a little flight school that happens right in front of the hive. If you come to a beehive in the middle of spring or summer, you will see a whole bunch of bees in the middle of the day just flying around little circles right in front of the entrance. They'll go out, they'll fly in circles, and they'll come back and they'll land. And they'll do this for a couple days, and that's how they learn to fly. Okay, so it's literally like flight school, just where the bees are learning to fly. Okay, so these guys are just coming in and out, and they're not dangerous. I mean, I could literally be standing right here, and these things wouldn't care about me. They'd just be flying in and out. Okay, now eventually, once they've learned to fly, they become the foragers. This point, they will leave the hive, and they will go look for nectar and pollen. Now, honeybees will fly in a 2-mile radius. So I want you to imagine my beehives right here. They'll fly 2 miles this way, 2 miles that way, 2 miles that way, 2 miles that way. It's a big area which bees can fly. So a lot of people that have bees are like, oh, I need to plant some flowers in my yard. Sure, they'll take advantage of that, but you don't need to. They will fly all over. So I live about 5 miles from here, so my bees aren't making it this far, but they'll fly very far. They will go out and they'll find nectar and pollen. Now, if you guys look at these bees coming back in, you guys see this thing right here? This is pollen. They have these special hairs on their legs, which we call a pollen basket. They take the pollen from the flower, which is literally plant sperm, and they store it on their legs. Okay, they bring it into the hive and they store it, and again, this is their main source of protein. The nectar they eat using a proboscis, and they store inside of their stomach. I already said this, so they bring the nectar back in their stomachs. That was one of my bees I just want to show. That's his pollen basket. My camera's not the highest quality. And if you look very closely, you can see his little hairs. He's got honeybees are really furry. They have a bunch of pollen stuck to their fur. This is how bees are able to pollinate different flowers. When they're collecting the pollen from one flower and they fly to another flower of the same species, some of this pollen, which again is plant sperm, occasionally accidentally ends up fertilizing the flower. So that's how bees are why bees are very important for the environment. Okay, once the bee returns back to the hive, it is literally going to regurgitate that honey. It has a special stomach called the honey stomach. It's going to literally vomit that nectar out and is going to put it into the honeycomb. Okay, so here you guys can see some honeycomb down here, which is not what's called capped. And up here you guys can see the honeycomb that's capped. They will fill up one of the honeycombs, okay, the hexagon shapes, until it gets full. Once it gets full, they will let it sit there and they'll actually fan it with their wings until the moisture level drops to about 13 to 18%. This is a very important number because once it gets to that point, they will cap it. Does anybody know what's significant about why do they wait till it gets that low? Honey is the only substance that we know of that has no expiration date. This is some of my honey from a couple years ago. This honey, if I seal this jar, I could let this sit here for 10,000 years. If you came back 10,000 years, you could still eat this. Okay, honey has a very low amount of water, so low that nothing can live in it. Bacteria cannot survive in here. There's not enough water, they will actually die. So they've actually found honey in the Egyptian pyramids from like 5,000 years ago that's still good. Okay, so it's the only honey, the only food product we know that does not have an expiration date. So it's very important when I go to collect my honey, this thing is called a frame. When I pull these things out, I will not take the frame unless it is mostly capped over, like this. If most of the frame looks like this, I won't touch it. Because if I take it and I take this honey and I put it in a jar like this, it's going to start rotting. Bacteria will start growing in here and it will go bad. So that would be bad business if I sold some honey to somebody and then it rotted in their cabinet. So it's very important that this water level gets very low. Now, what about water? Bees need to drink. It's important that bees have a water source close by, at least as far as local regulations go. You're supposed to have a water source in your yard. This can be as simple as just like a bird bath. You can just put like a bowl of water, and you tend to put things in it like corks or rocks because the bees can't swim. If they land just in the water, they'll drown. So they always land on something in the water on the edge, and they'll stick their little proboscis down and drink. Some people have bees if their neighbors have a pool. Sometimes their neighbors are a little mad if you don't give them a close water source because their water source will become the neighbor's pool. Okay, so this is a typical frame. If I pulled this out in the middle of summer, this is what a typical frame would look like. Okay, so over here, if you guys look really closely, you see these white things? These are the larvae. Okay, it kind of looks like a grub, like from like a Lion King, you know, he's like Hakuna Matata and he eats that grub. They kind of look like that. They're these little white things. They get bigger. They look like a little grain of rice when they're just laid, and they get bigger and bigger. Once they get to a certain size, the nurse bees cap it over and allow them to finish developing. Eventually, they will chew their way out, and they will become one of these bees. Okay, now around them, you see the ones that have different like yellowish colors. These are pollen. So that's the pollen they collect from the plants. Again, that is the main protein source. And then around that, generally around the outside of the frame, is where the honey is stored. So all of this is capped honey. So this honey is ready to go. It's ready to be used for food. Okay, so the bees won't eat it unless it's already been capped. Okay, now what about communication? I told you bees can't talk to each other. They communicate via pheromones to attack. But how do they tell other bees where to go? Bees have a dance. And I know this sounds made up, but I swear this is true. Bees do two different dances. They do the round dance or what's called the waggle dance. And it depends on the scenario here. Okay, so let's pretend I'm a bee. Let's pretend we're all bees. This is our beehive. We're inside the beehive. Let's say I'm a worker bee. I just found a bunch of flowers like 100 yards away. They're very close to the hive. I am going to do this little waggle dance. The bees literally move in this specific motion, and they will literally tell the bees that are other bees that are watching, hey, there's something close by. They'll generally actually open up their little proboscis, the little tube, and they'll actually transfer a little bit of nectar to the other bees and say, look, I found this. Okay, this dance does not tell them where to go. It just tells them there's something very close. So a bunch of the bees will go out and look for that specific area. But let's say something's like 2 miles away. I told you that bees will go 2 mile radius. How does the bee tell the rest of the bees in the hive, hey, there's flowers, big flower field, 2 miles in that specific direction? They will do this dance called the waggle dance. They will literally orient themselves based on the sun. They know where the sun is, and they will literally waggle in a specific angle that points the other bees in the hive to that specific direction. Okay, so they, Hannah, how's it going? So that's the waggle dance. So they will literally orient themselves based on where the sun is. I'm not going to read all this to you, but they will literally waggle like they'll go directly towards the sun if it's going that way. If the nectar source is down here, they'll waggle this way, the opposite direction from the sun. So they orient themselves in the way they do that little waggle based on the sun's location. Now, the distance that they waggle, the length that they waggle, gives an indication for how far in distance the nectar source is. Okay, so that's kind of cool. That wasn't actually discovered until like the early 1900s that they did that. Okay, next I want to talk about, this is the worst part about beekeeping, these guys. You see this little thing right here? Kind of looks like a little tick. This is called a mite. It's called a varroa mite. Their actual scientific name is Varroa destructor. This is a little mite that came over from all places, China. Okay, in the late 1900s, like I'm talking 1990s, some honeybees were brought over, some Asian honeybees were brought over from China, and they came here. When they were brought over, they brought these little insects with them called varroa mites. These things are the main issue that is causing honeybee populations in America to plummet. You may have seen, I see billboards all around the city that say, protect them or lose them, and there's a picture of a honeybee. This is the main thing that's killing honeybees, right here. It's this little insect. Okay, this little insect gets on the bees, particularly when they're in their larval stage, and they will literally chew on them, and they'll feed off of the liquids inside of the baby larvae, and the larvae will either not survive or it will be born with a bunch of defects, and it basically won't be a productive member of the society. So once the bee crawls out, these mites crawl out of that one, and they crawl into a different one, and they just do this over and over and over. So they feed off the baby bees. Now, the issue is getting rid of them. They're tough to get rid of. So as a beekeeper, once or twice a year, I actually treat my bees with some chemicals. And I know that sounds bad. I basically give them a little medication to kill these bees. I use a material that's actually natural. It's called oxalic acid. It's found in all plants, so it's not some synthetic material that man made. Basically, I take my hive. Let me just go to a picture of a hive real quick. Okay, this is what a hive looks like. I imagine this is sealed up. This is what my hive used to look like my first year I did it. It looks a lot better now. I take a little machine, I stick it in the entrance, and I put some of this oxalic acid and I heat it up and it turns into a vapor. And it basically puts this whole smoke vapor that runs all throughout the hive. Now, oxalic acid is harmless to the honeybees. It's naturally found in plants. For whatever reason, it kills the mites. So I trap all the bees in, I put the smoke in, it rises all the way up to the top of the hive, and I let it sit in there for about 2 minutes. And then I pull it out, and I come back the next day, you will see hundreds or thousands of the mites, which were all over the bees, they died and they fall all the way to the bottom. Okay, and you can just see it work immediately. Now, so that's what most people do to get rid of these guys, because if you don't do this, your bees will probably die in the wintertime. I know this sounds terrible, but about 50% of beehives die in the wintertime. 50. Think about that. 50% survival rate. Okay, so I think this is my sixth year I've been doing this. My first year, I did not treat for these guys because I was brand new. I didn't really know much about them. My bees survived. The next year, I didn't treat them. They died. The next year, I didn't treat them. They died. Okay? The fourth year, I treated them. They survived. Fifth year, I treated them. They survived. And then this is my sixth year. I've treated them this year. So I have found from my own personal experience, if you don't treat for these things, they just slowly, over the course of the winter, they just eat away at your bees, and they kill them. So you come back in spring, your bees are all gone. They're all dead because of these guys. So these are what's called colony collapse disorder. This is the main thing that's kind of hurting the bees. Okay, now as far as collecting the honey, which is kind of the fun part, so twice a year, I go usually in June and then in September, October, I go into my hive and I pull out the frames. Again, this is what a frame looks like, which is in the beehive. Again, you can see this is a box. There's usually 10 frames in a box. You can also get ones that have 8, but mine have 10 frames in them. I pull these frames out and I will check them. Now, if you guys can see from here, you guys see how white it is right here? All that white stuff you guys are looking at is called capped honey. Again, that's where it's sealed over. It's ready to be eaten by me/the bees. I will pull this frame out. If it is mostly on both sides, because it's double-sided, if it's mostly capped, I will take it. I will take a little brush. I'll gently brush the bees off, and I'll put it into a second box. Okay? I'll go through my hives, and I'll take as much honey as I think is appropriate. Now, it's important you don't take all the honey, because that's how the bees survive the winter. They make the honey for a reason. That's their food. Right now, my bees are just sitting in their hive, literally beating their wings to stay warm and eating honey. If I took all their honey, they would all starve to death. Okay, A, I don't want to kill my bees. B, I would have to buy new bees the next year, which is not cheap. Bees cost about $150 to buy a little hive of them. So I want to make sure I don't have to pay $150, and I don't want to kill my bees. So I leave them enough honey to survive the winter. I take as much honey as I think is reasonable, and I'll pull these frames out. I'll take them into my house, okay, and I will take a little, basically kind of looks like a comb. I also have a big knife. And I basically scrape just the very top layer of the wax off. Just the very top layer. Like I'm talking about like a millimeter. Not much. Just these wax cappings are very thin. And underneath is the honey. I will take these frames and I'll put into this machine right here, which is a honey extractor. It's basically a big centrifuge. If you guys know what a centrifuge is, it's a machine that spins stuff in a circle. I will put the frames into the centrifuge. Mine's not this big. Mine only fits 3 frames. But I put the frames in like this, I put a little lid on it, and there's a crank right here, and I sit there and I crank it, and it's a lot of work. I stand on it so it doesn't like bounce all over like a washing machine, and I crank it for like 2 minutes. The honey will fly out against the wall, okay? Then I gotta stop it, and I actually have to rotate the frames to do the other side. I'll crank it again, okay? Now the honey is flying out against the wall, the metal wall, and it will slowly drip down to the bottom. And on the bottom, there is a little valve. We call this the honey gate. Okay, that's its actual name. Okay, I open the honey gate, and underneath it, I have a little sieve. Think of like a filter. I have a double filter to filter out any little bit of particles of wax or any other thing that might be in there that I don't want in the honey. It will slowly run through the filters, and it will run into a big bucket. Okay, once it gets into that bucket, I can't remember if I put any pictures. I did not put any pictures in here. After it gets into that bucket, I then just fill up my jars, like this guy, okay? And I fill up a bunch of them. This year is my most productive year. I've gotten 130 pounds of honey this year. I want you to think about that. That is a ton of honey. Now, I don't do this for the money, but if any of you are interested in becoming a beekeeper, you can make a lot of money off it. So this year, I've gotten approximately 130 pounds of honey. If I want, depending on who I'm selling it to, if I'm selling it to friends or family or just random people, I can sell my honey from anywhere between $10 to $15 per pound. let's just use the conservative number of 10. That gets me $1,300 of honey. That's just for this year. Okay, now I also collect that wax. Remember I told you I scrape off this wax? I also scrape off that wax, I filter it, I clean it up, and I make some chapstick or lip balm out of it, and I also sell that. I really meant to bring some lip balm. I usually raffle some off at the end of this, and I give some out to you guys. I'll try to bring some in, but I forgot today. And I sell that as well. So you can make money on this. Now, as far as beekeeping, though, it is a very expensive hobby to get into. There's a lot of upfront costs, because all these parts you see right here, these things cost money. Like each one of these boxes costs about 20 bucks. The frames, I told you there's about 10 frames. Those frames cost about $1.50 each. So think about it, that's what, 15 bucks, 35 bucks just for a box full of frames. Okay, most of my hives have four boxes on them. Okay, then this lid costs like 30 bucks. This inner cover costs like 20 bucks. I have a thing on the bottom, the base of it costs about another 25 bucks. All these parts add up. The suit, this was my first year. My first year I told you I was just getting involved in it. I went as cheap as I could. I literally just bought a veil. You can see how I'm kind of dumb here. I'm not even wearing gloves. I've progressed a lot over the years. My first year, I'm literally just wearing a long sleeve shirt and a veil. The veils are super cheap, but I've now invested in a full bee suit. Literally covers me from head to toe. Costs about 150 bucks. I have little tools, this little holder, this little beekeeping tool. Those things cost like 10 bucks each. There's a smoker, it costs 20 bucks. That little extractor, this thing costs like 120 bucks. So there's a lot of upfront cost, but I bought them all my first and second year, and since then, I don't need anything. I have everything I need, and now it's just pure profit. I just pump out honey, and I sell it / give it away to friends and family. It makes great presents for holidays and birthday presents. That's just some pictures. I think this was early this year. This is me and my buddy. He was just coming over to help me. This is me pulling out the frame. He's holding the brush. I told you this is the honey I was going to take. He's going to brush the bees off, and then I put it into a box and take it into my house. That's one of my harvests from last year, I think. That was just from one day in June. I can't remember. That was like 60 pounds of honey. Jarred it up. Some of the jars I put some honeycomb into because some people like eating the actual honeycomb. I sell those. I sell those for a little bit more. Wintertime. Wintertime, I take my bees. You don't have to do this, but I take my bees and I put a big insulating wrap around it. You guys know like a koozie you put on a can of Coke to keep it cold? It's basically, they're actually called bee cozies. You put it on and it literally keeps the beehive a little bit warmer in the wintertime. It insulates them. Up top, I put this little box up here, and in this box is a whole bunch of wood chips. The wood chips are there to absorb any moisture because that's what actually kills the bees in the winter other than the mites. If you get moisture that builds up on the top because the bees are keeping it warm inside there, the moisture drips on the bees and it can freeze them to death. So this is here to help the moisture control. As far as the winter goes, the bees literally sit and they clump into a big ball. They actually make a ball about the size of like a small basketball and they literally just eat the honey and beat their wings. Okay, they keep the inside of the hive, at least the inside of the cluster, about 93 degrees all winter. It could be negative 20 outside, could be in Canada, negative 30. They're keeping it 90, 93, 94 degrees in that little cluster. Okay, the queen stays in the middle, and as they eat the honey, they move to different parts of the hive and eat the honey. And if they run out of honey, they die. So I also, I don't know if you guys can see this like wooden layer right here, I also put a little layer, I put about 15 pounds of sugar. I make a sugar cake. It's literally 15 pounds of sugar, and I put a couple teaspoons of water in it. I stir it up, and I basically form it into a cake, and I put it in there. I put that in there so the bees will eat the sugar instead of the honey for my own selfish reasons so I can harvest more honey the next year. Additionally, because if the bees run out of honey, they'll still have the sugar to eat. So a lot of beekeepers provide them with sugar to help supplement them throughout the winter. My first year, I literally was trying to do as cheap as possible. I built my own hive. I'm no way a carpenter or anything like that. I literally looked up plans online. I built a stand. I literally built all these pieces you're seeing. So if you're interested in doing this, you can build it, or you can just buy the pieces. I'm going to be honest with you, after building it, it was a lot of work, and it was only saved me a couple bucks. It's a lot better if you just buy your own buy stuff, because it's going to be higher quality unless you're a good worksman, good craftsman, and it's not much more expensive. This is what a frame looks like if you pull it out and just there's bees on it. Okay, I want to save a little bit of time. Does anybody have any questions? I know I went through a lot of stuff real quick. Does anybody have any questions about like bees in general or beekeeping? Yeah.
Have you seen two queens?
Okay, so remember I told you in the middle of summer there's about like 70,000 bees? So the number of times I actually see the queen is not often because I don't really care to look for her because there's 70,000 bees. It'd be like playing Where's Waldo, but a lot harder. So no, I've never actually physically seen two queens at the same time, but I know it definitely happens because eventually, sometimes I'll see my queen and I can tell they change. You can actually mark your queen. You take a little marker and you put a little spot on her back. You use a different color for different years. Like some years are blue, some years are green, some years are yellow. And so like if I see a different queen, I see it doesn't have a dot on it, I know my other queen's gone and they've replaced her. So no.
You mentioned like eating the honeycomb, and I know like raw honey like from Costco, I think the difference is like it has honeycomb in it. Can you actually like just eat this?
You could eat wax. I mean, your body is probably gonna mostly just pass right through your body, but yes, you can definitely eat it. By the way, I'm glad you mentioned that. Most of the honey you buy in the, please don't eat it. Most of the honey you buy in store is actually not honey. The FDA does not regulate honey. So if you go to the store and buy honey, you probably are not buying something made by bees. I think the number is about 80% of honey sold in America is not made by bees. They make it in a factory and they just call it honey. It's literally just a sugar solution that they made and labeled it honey. This is real honey, came from bees. The stuff you buy in stores is usually not actual honey.
Kind of just tastes like nothing.
Okay, don't eat any more. Yeah, that's like 5 years old. It's been sitting in that cabinet for 5 years. I'm sure it's fine, but let's not eat. Okay, anybody else have any other questions? If anybody's interested in actually getting started beekeeping, I'll help you. It's not that hard to get started. I know it's a little scary at first, but once you get the bee suit, you're totally fine. Bees can't really sting you if you take the proper precautions. The only time I ever get stung is when I'm too lazy to put my bee suit on and I just go out there. Honeybees are very not aggressive. Like my first year, I have little nephews and nieces. They would literally come and stand right here outside of my hive, like right here, and they would literally, I'm not just saying, they would literally pet the bees. I'd have little kids just sitting there petting the bees, never got stung. So honeybees will sting, but they die when they sting you. So they only sting you if they feel that you are aggressive or you're gonna harm the hive. Any other questions, comments? Okay, well, thanks again for attending. If you guys have any other questions about bees in the future or you want to get involved in it, I'm here to help. So, thank you.